Regarding asset-based disturbance, when you have a scenario and getting you a report of IBG, blood gas report should be read in correlation with the clinical setting. Actually, the scenario itself can carry the interpretation of blood gas report. So when reading a blood gas report, we look at the pH, carbon dioxide, oxygen, and bicarb. Okay, so a pH or the power of hydrogen ions in the plasma, which is normally 7.35 to 7.45. Okay, so having this number high, more than 7.45, this means we are towards the alkalotic side, and vice versa, if it is below 7.35, okay, so we are on the acidotic side. These changes of pH either toward alkalosis or acidosis can result from either a changes in carbon dioxide levels or bicarb level, the main alkali in the body. Okay, so changes of bicarb level, of carbon dioxide levels, usually caused by respiratory illnesses. Okay, so it will be discussed in details in the chapter of chest or respiratory, as washing of carbon dioxide will result in alkalotic pH, while accumulation of carbon dioxide will result in acidotic pH. So as regard the alkali accumulation or depletion, it also will result in acid-base imbalance. High level of bicarb will cause shift of pH to the alkalotic side, okay, and so it's called metabolic alkalosis. While depletion of bicarb, loss of bicarb from the body will be associated, or addition of acids to the body will be associated of lowering of bicarb level and lowering of the pH, okay, and the metabolic acidosis. So you know, usually the body will compensate for any acid-base imbalance will occur. So having conditions that associated with elevation of bicarb level, as in this case, for example, we know the normal bicarb level is 22 to 26. So having it 31, so we have high alkali level. The body will respond by elevation of the carbon dioxide level, okay, in order to normalize the pH. Okay, so elevation of bicarb will be compensated by elevation of carbon dioxide level. Okay, so how we elevate carbon dioxide level? By reduction of the respiratory rate. The patient will show hypopnea or reduction of respiratory rate to reduce excretion rate of carbon dioxide from the body and compensate for the high alkali level. You know, normal carbon dioxide level is 35 to 45 here at the upper borderline. Okay, on the other hand, depletion or lowering of carbon dioxide level will be compensated by the body by depletion or lowering carbon dioxide level. Depletion of bicarb will be compensated by depletion of carbon dioxide through hyperventilation. The patient will be tachypneic to increase the excretion rate of carbon dioxide from the body. Okay, so we have metabolic causes for acid-base imbalance. We'll discuss here in this chapter, while the respiratory causes for acid-base imbalance will be discussed in another chapter. Okay, starting with metabolic acidosis. What are the causes of metabolic acidosis? It is a primary reduction in bicarb. So the main or the primary pathology was reduction of bicarb that result in reduction of pH, and the body will respond by reduction of carbon dioxide normally. Okay, and get a note, if you find that the body didn't or doesn't compensate for this acid-base balance, so expect that you have another additional pathology, and this is called mixed disturbance. So in this blood gas report, where we have the pH is somewhat at the upper borderline, bicarb at the upper borderline, and bicarb is high, so the primary change was elevation of bicarb that resulted in elevation of pH that was compensated by elevation of carbon dioxide, and so the pH somewhat normalized or kept near normal levels. So if you find the carbon dioxide level is maybe 22, for example. Okay, so we don't have elevation of carbon, or it's, if it's normal, even if it is just 30 or 35. So normal carbon dioxide levels facing this high alkali level means that we have wash out of the carbon dioxide, okay, by another condition. Okay, so we may have, for example, a newborn in the NICU who is receiving furosemide, okay, and the furosemide, you know, pseudobarter, some condition will be present, resulting in metabolic alkalosis. Okay, so if this newborn also has an respiratory distress for any cause, maybe RDS, maybe pneumonia, okay, associated with tachypnea and the increased wash out of carbon dioxide, so you will find that carbon dioxide wasn't elevated, maybe kept normal or even subnormal, okay, and so the pH will be affected and will toward the more strong condition. Okay, this is called mixed disturbance. On the other hand, if you have acidosis by carbs low, okay, maybe 10 for example rather than 22, so low bicarb will be associated by lowering of pH and compensated by lowering of carbon dioxide. So if you have carbon dioxide not lowered, maybe normal, maybe high, finding it normal facing the low bicarb level indicates this carbon dioxide is abnormally high. So you have a respiratory condition that resulted in carbon dioxide accumulation, like pneumonia, for example, in its later stages when it is associated with impairment of respiratory function and the accumulation of carbon dioxide. So this is called a mixed disturbance. So it will be rediscussed in the chapter of respiratory, starting now with simple metabolic acidosis, just primary reduction of bicarb and reduction of pH levels. This can be caused by bicarb loss accompanying GIT losses in case of diarrhea, or it may be renal losses in case of the tubular defects, type 1 and type 2 tubular acidosis. It can be due to reduced or diminished hydrogen ion excretion, as occur in type 1 RTA, where there is impaired acidification, impaired hydrogen ion excretion in urine, resulting in acidosis. Also, acute or chronic renal failure, accumulation of the acidic waste products in the body due to impaired glomerular filtration will result in acidosis. Both bicarb loss and reduced hydrogen ion concentration will be associated with normal anion gap metabolic acidosis because you just lost bicarb and not gained any acid loads. But here, look at increasing hydrogen ion load, either endogenous or exogenous. So maybe exogenous in case of salicylate poisoning, for example. So acquisition of these acids from outside the body will cause you metabolic acidosis due to ingestion of these acids, and it will be high anion gap metabolic acidosis, meaning that the anion gap will be more than 20. Endogenous load, and in case of inborn error of metabolism, like maple syrup urine disease or propionic acidemia, these are associated with accumulation of organic acids. Okay, due to defects in its catabolic pathway, accumulation of organic acids will add to the acidic load inside the body, giving you the high anion gap metabolic acidosis. The same in lactic acidosis, accompanying any case of hypoperfusion, any case of shock. Whatever the cause, shock or hypoperfusion, even in heart failure, can be associated with shift of the glycolysis from the aerobic to anaerobic side, production of high amounts of lactate and lactic acidosis. So addition of lactate to the body will cause the high anion gap metabolic acidosis. The same occurs in diabetic ketoacidosis with accumulation of keto acids. Okay, so in any case of metabolic acidosis, you must calculate the anion gap through getting the serum levels of cations and anions and subtract the sum of anions, bicarb and chloride, from the sum of cations, sodium and potassium. Normally it is less than 20. It's said to be between 8 to 16. Up to 20, this can be normal. And beyond 20, maybe DKA, maybe lactic acidosis, maybe salicylate poisoning, maybe renal failure. Okay, even renal failure can start with normal anion gap. And then when more and more waste product accumulation, it will end by the high and longer metabolic acidosis. So it is said in DKA, if you find that anion gap is more than 35 in diabetic ketoacidosis, this is very high and expect you have a combined cause for metabolic acidosis, both DKA, okay, and associated with shock that resulted in lactic acidosis. Okay, remember that the hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis with normal anion gap was seen in cases of RTE. Okay, so this was metabolic acidosis with its causes, either loss of bicarb, impaired hydrogen ion excretion, or addition of hydrogen ion, or addition of load of acids. Okay, and we have normal anion gap and high anion gap metabolic acidosis. On the other side, metabolic alkalosis, when the alkali load is increased in the body. Okay, so we have primary increase in plasma bicarb levels that will result in increase of DH that will be compensated by elevation of carbon dioxide levels through hypopnea. So this can be due to either chloride depletion. Chloride depletion will be compensated by excessive bicarb reabsorption from renal tubules, so alkalosis, or it may be due to hydrogen secretion by the kidney. Okay, chloride depletion in cases of GI loss is like pyloric stenosis. The persistent vomiting will result in persistent chloride loss. And the vomitus, also congenital chloride diarrhea, so loss through the stool. And furosemide therapy, okay, again and again, furosemide therapy act on the loop of Henle, on the transporter, sodium, potassium, chloride, excessive excretion of sodium, potassium, and the chloride will be compensated by excessive reabsorption of bicarb and metabolic alkalosis. Cystic fibrosis, the same, all these are pseudobarter conditions, you know, and in cystic fibrosis, there was excessive sodium chloride loss and sweat. Okay, other causes for metabolic alkalosis include Parter syndrome, we have discussed, and the tubular defects, also Cushing syndrome and hyperaldosteronism. Both in Cushing, we have excessive action of corticosteroid. Corticosteroid also have mineralocorticoid effect, and in case of hyperaldosteronism, we have excess mineralocorticoid effect. These both are associated with excessive sodium and water retention, okay, and loss of potassium, okay, with metabolic alkalosis and hypertension. So you have an adolescent boy who was brought to the ER as his parents had trouble awakening him this morning. He has become increasingly fatigued over the past months and has been getting up multiple times at night to use the bathroom. The boy is drowsy but answers questions appropriately. His temperature is normal, blood pressure 90 over 50, heart rate, tachycardia, respiratory rate 18, saturation normal, weight 110, and he has acanthosis, and now he has dry mucous membranes and capillary refill time of 4 seconds. Okay, these are labs. His plasma glucose is 1000 milligram per dl, his sodium is high. Okay, and you know, normal sodium is 135 to 145. Bicarb is normal, 22. Urea nitrogen is high. Okay, creatinine also it's high, 1.8. It's high, and serum osmolarity is 388. Okay, and his pH is 7.34. Somewhat normal, and ketones are negative. What is the best next management step for this boy? Okay, try to read and answer the question. So about the fluid homeostasis. Fluid homeostasis. Normally, preterm infant has 85% of his body weight formed of water, okay? While the term infant has 80% of his weight formed of water, the older a child and the adult has 60% of his weight formed of water, okay? And this water or fluid is distributed as follows. Two-thirds of this fluid is intracellular, okay? The remaining third is extracellular fluid. The extracellular is redistributed between the interstitial fluid, 34th of of the extracellular fluid is interstitial, while the remaining force, okay, is here intravascular. Intravascular. These spaces are separated by semi-permeable membranes, where we have different concentrations of solutes inside these fluids. Okay, so these solutes will move freely across these semi-permeable membranes, depending on its concentration, depending on osmolarity, you know, across the osmotic gradient. So solutes will, and the fluid, okay, actually will move from the high osmolar to the, or from the low osmolar to the high osmolar space. Okay. So body compartments are separated by semi-permeable membranes and allowing for free movement of water along the osmotic gradient. It's important to know about the extracellular fluid osmolarity. Serum osmolarity is an important item, and we calculate it through this equation. Sodium plus potassium multiplied by 2 plus glucose in milligram per dl, okay, and urine. The normal level for serum osmolarity is 285 to 295. You know, you can note that, you'll notice that the main determinant of serum osmolarity is the sodium and the glucose levels. So cases of hypernatremia result in higher serum osmolarity. Cases of hyperglycemia result in higher serum osmolarity. These are the main determinants of serum osmolarity. This is very important. And if we have high serum osmolarity, what will occur? So increase in extracellular fluid osmolarity will result in move from the lower to the higher osmotic concentration. So if you have here in the plasma high osmolarity due to hypernatremia or hyperglycemia, so you expect the fluid will move from the intracellular space to the the intravascular space, to the higher osmolarity, resulting in cellular dehydration. And the most important cell in the body is the brain cell. So brain cell dehydration will occur. This is very dangerous. And so the body will accommodate by production of these, that's called organic osmolytes or endosmolar granules. These granules increase the osmolarity here in the intracellular space to guard against cellular dehydration with the high serum osmolarity. And this should be reflected on your management for any case of serum high serum osmolarity, like DKA, for example. This was present in our boy, okay, who was in shock now, and any other causes of hypernatremia. Also, any cause of hypernatremia means we have high serum osmolarity, and so also it should be treated cautiously. How treated cautiously? By gradual correction of the main pathology, gradual addition of fluids or restoration of the fluid balance, gradual reduction of sodium levels, gradual reductions of glucose level to guard against rapid reduction in the serum osmolarity. As if you suddenly reduce the serum osmolarity, this will result that the fluid here will move to the higher osmolarity here in the intracellular, resulting in cellular edema and brain edema, which is highly dangerous, okay, and they can be fatal. So how, in case of increased serum osmolarity, the body accommodates, as we have mentioned, through generation of intracellular organic osmolytes, through increasing the secretion of antidiuretic hormone to withhold water and reduce urine output, okay, to dilute the high osmolarity. Also by stimulation of thirst sensation to allow for increase the fluid intake, okay. And now another problem. Let's get back to our question first. This boy has very high level of glucose. He actually diabetic, but with normal creat level and with normal bicarb, he is not in acidosis, and this is a characteristic for a condition called hyperosmolar state, which enters in the differential diagnosis of DKA. In DKA, we have hyperglycemia with metabolic acidosis, but here in the hyperosmolar state, that also accompany diabetes, and actually this patient is very obese and has acanthosis nigricans, so is mostly has type 2 diabetes, okay? And this type 2 diabetes now is complicated by the hyperosmolar state. Very high level of glucose with normal pH, okay? And this very high level was complicated by excessive osmotic diuresis, okay, resulting in severe dehydration up to shock. Our patient is shocked. His capillary refill time is 4 seconds. So he is extremely dehydrated and shocked. And this resulted in hypernatremia, okay, due to excessive water loss from the body. So sodium is very high. And also urea and the creatinine are high due to the excessive water loss and the pre-renal impairment, okay? And see the serum osmolarity. Serum osmolarity is very high. It's normal up to 295. It is here more than 300, 380. Very high serum osmolarity. This can be fatal, okay? But this is a tricky question because he is asking you about the best next management step. It would be number D, that your patient is shocked, so your priority is the shock therapy with normal saline, 20 mL/kg bolus, to be repeated as needed to restore perfusion and to treat the shock, okay? After shock therapy and after restoration of perfusion, you can start with A, okay, using the half normal saline infusion with potassium, okay, at the twice maintenance rate. These conditions require copious fluid administration, okay, to compensate for the shock, compensate for the dehydration, and to reduce serum osmolarity. But this should be done cautiously with meticulous calculation of fluid input, fluid output, calculation of urine output, monitoring for serum osmolarity every few hours through getting levels of glucose, levels of sodium, to guard against rapid reduction in electrolyte level and in serum osmolarity. This infant brought to the ER after 3 days of vomiting and diarrhea. During the illness, he was given a diluted powdered formula and small amounts of water by his parents. He is lethargic and has a weak cry. His heart rate is tachycardic and respiratory 22, blood pressure, and his capillary refill is more than 2 seconds, okay? His sodium is 119, it's low, and potassium at low normal, and chloride normal, bicarb 18, blood urea nitrogen is 28, creatinine is 0.5, glucose is 90, okay, and his serum osmolarity is 258. Okay, so what is the most accurate next step? What is the most accurate statement? Try to read and answer the question. Okay, so this boy had gastroenteritis that was complicated by hyponatremic dehydration. Now he is in shock, having a prolonged capillary refill time with low sodium levels, okay? And see that, notice that the low sodium level resulting in very low serum osmolarity level. His osmolarity is 258, it's low, okay? What will this result, okay? So rapid onset may lead to subarachnoid hemorrhage. No, hypernatremia is the more common condition associated with subarachnoid hemorrhage rather than hyponatremia. Rapid correction will lead to cerebral edema caused by osmolar shifts. Okay, so rapid correction in this case, he mean by sodium infusion. And sodium infusion, rapid correction will result in osmotic shift from cell to the intravascular space, resulting in cellular dehydration rather than edema. This is not right. And the intracellular sodium has increased because of fluid Shift no, we have low sodium rather than high sodium. So the right answer is A. Fluid has shifted from the extracellular to intracellular compartment following the osmotic gradient. So what about sodium levels? Sodium normally between 135 to 145. Having hyponatremia means that the sodium levels is below 130 millimole per liter. This can result. You know that sodium and water are highly correlated to each other, and so water will follow sodium whenever he goes. Okay, so in case of gain of excess water, okay, in excess of sodium, this will result in dilution of sodium levels in the serum and the hyponatremia. When we gain excess water, in case of maybe iatrogenic, as giving hypotonic oral or IV fluids, as occurred in our infant. His parents gave him a diluted powdered formula, so they gave him hypotonic fluids excessively while he was having gastroenteritis. So this is iatrogenic cause for the hyponatremia. In cases of psychogenic polydipsia, a child who is drinking excessively and usually their parents come to complain that they are drinking excessively and producing urine excessively. Those cases can show hypernatremia. A hyponatremia related to the excess water intake. And usually in those patients, water deprivation will result in reduction of urine output production and diagnose the case of psychogenic polydipsia. Also doing a simultaneous serum and urine osmolarity will exclude diabetes insipidus as a cause for their polyuria, as usually they have low serum osmolarity and low urine osmolarity. Okay, and the contrary, diabetes insipidus as a cause of polyuria showed high serum osmolarity in the face of low urine osmolarity. Okay, so psychogenic polydipsia is associated with hyponatremia, while diabetes insipidus was associated with hypernatremia due to excess water loss. Okay, psychogenic polydipsia will have low serum osmolarity, while in diabetes insipidus they have high serum osmolarity due to the dehydration. Okay, and hypernatremia. Acute renal failure with retention of fluids can be accompanied by hyponatremia, dilutional. Also, the famous syndrome of inappropriate secretion of antidiuretic hormone. In a case, in usually in ICU, with CNS, maybe infection, tumor, okay, or any respiratory illness like pneumonia, patient may be mechanically ventilated or has received a medication like carbamazepine. All these conditions can be associated with inappropriate secretion, excessive secretion of antidiuretic hormone, so withholding water inside the body, marked reduction of urine output, and so you will have high urine osmolarity, okay, due to the high concentration of solute in relation to water. And on the contrary, the serum will show low serum osmolarity due to excessive retention of water and dilutional hyponatremia. Important area of question asking you about the cause of hyponatremia in this condition, it is dilutional hyponatremia. Okay, the treatment is just fluid restriction. Okay, and interestingly, those cases are not associated with hypertension, and the treatment of the condition plus fluid restriction will manage the case, unless you have severe symptomatic hyponatremia that is complicated by seizures, complicated by coma, and severe neurological manifestation. In this case, so infusion of sodium in the form of hypertonic saline, okay, over 4 hours to reach sodium levels of 125 to 130. Okay, so you don't normalize sodium level just to reach the level of 125 to 130, and you should do it cautiously and gradually to avoid sudden changes in serum osmolarity. Okay, another cause for hyponatremia is loss of sodium. loss of sodium. So having sodium level below 130 due to renal losses of sodium as occur in acute kidney injury. Having intrinsic pathology in the kidney, now kidney is not capable of retention or reabsorption of sodium in renal tubules, so urine sodium will be high, will be more than 20. Fractional excretion will be more than 1%. Okay, this is a cause. Also, the use of loop diuretics excessively. Their mechanism depend on excessive sodium excretion in urine. Recovery phase of acute tubular necrosis. These tubules are not capable of retention of sodium. Any tubulopathy like Fanconi syndrome, okay. Salt wasting, congenital adrenal hyperplasia. In congenital adrenal hyperplasia and in any case of adrenal insufficiency like Addison disease, whatever, okay. So loss of the mineralocorticoid effect of aldosterone will be associated with potassium retention and hypokalemia, hyperkalemia plus loss of sodium and water, okay. So this was loss of sodium in excess of water. Other losses of sodium that are extrarenal include its GIT losses. We can lose sodium in stool in cases of gastroenteritis, as in our infant. Also can lose sodium through the skin, as in case of cystic fibrosis or in case of severe sweating and severe hot temperature. Okay. For all cases of hyponatremia, so just fluid management is what is required. When we maintain fluid balance, sodium levels will be maintained okay following it. But you should intervene when you have severe symptomatic cases, okay, and usually disturbance in sodium levels, either hypo or hypernatremia, will manifest by neurological manifestations in the form of seizures, headaches, okay, and up to coma, and they can be fatal. Actually, arrhythmias can occur and so on. For these, so appropriate rehydration therapy with meticulous electrolyte supplementation. Otherwise, if not sufficient, so you should infuse hypertonic saline IV with caution to reach the level to 125 to 130. On the other hand, having hypernatremia, so sodium more than 150 millimole per liter or milliequivalent per liter. Okay, why we have hypernatremia? Because we lose water in excess of sodium. This loss of water can be renal, as in cases of reduced renal concentration, concentrating ability. Okay, as in preterm babies have immature kidneys, they cannot maintain fluid balance, they lose water, and so can show hypernatremia. Any cause of kidney insult, all cases of acute kidney injury can be accompanied by hypernatremia due to excessive water losses. Diabetes insipidus, we have just mentioned the both pituitary and the nephrogenic entities of diabetes insipidus are associated with excessive losses of water and so hypernatremia. Okay, osmotic diuresis, as in case of diabetic ketoacidosis, excessive loss of glucose in urine, take water with it, okay, and resulting in dehydration. Dehydration will show the high sodium levels, okay. We may lose water through extrarenal sources like NGIT losses. Some types of gastroenteritis will be associated of hypernatremic dehydration. Other will be associated with hyponatremic dehydration. Others will be associated with isonatremic dehydration, depending on the loss was toward sodium or toward water. What was lost more, okay? Loss of water more will result in hypernatremic dehydration. Loss of sodium more will result in hyponatremic dehydration. So GIT losses, also the high and sensible water loss accompanying the hyperventilation and the fever. So excessive loss of water can be result in hypernatremia. Inadequate free water intake also can be a cause. The treatment for cases of hypernatremia as and hypernatremic dehydration, oral rehydration solution, the standard one. Okay, this is the safest option to use the oral route. And any scenario, usually can ask you about you choose oral route versus IV route, and usually they are towards the oral route. Oral route is the safest option to give the standard ORS and fluid with solute administration internally will correct for the defect in that's present in serum osmolarity. Otherwise, gradual correction of IV fluids in case of failure of oral fluids. So IV fluid using sodium chloride plus glucose plus potassium, okay, with reduction of no more than 10 to 15 millimole per liter, very important. Any osmolarity disturbance should be corrected gradually. So you correct for the high sodium levels by gradual reduction of its level with no more 10 to 15 millimole per day or 1 to 2 millimole per hour. Okay, this is very important to guard against rapid changes in osmolarity. Hypernatremia can be caused by gain of sodium. Gain of sodium. This can be iatrogenic. When you give excess hypertonic fluids, okay, this can be IV or can be oral. IV in case of you giving excessive amounts of sodium bicarb. Giving bicarb for treatment of acidosis, usually bicarb is in the form of sodium bicarb. So while you are treating the acidosis, you cause the patient hypernatremia. If you give excessive amount of hypertonic saline, you can cause hypernatremia to the patient. Incorrect reconstitution of infant formula. Okay, if the infant formula is concentrated and not prepared properly, it can cause hypernatremia, child abuse, or what's called Munchausen syndrome by proxy, when someone intend to abuse the child, giving him salt or salt poisoning can present in scenarios in the exam. Okay, where a newborn or an infant present with hypernatremia and no other obvious cause. Treatment should allow excess free water, okay, and remove the cause of excessive sodium gain. Okay. Now regarding potassium, potassium is normally between 3.5 to 5.5 millimole or milli equivalent per liter, and we have hypokalemia if the level is less than 3, and this can be due to prolonged IV fluid administration without potassium. Very important, any maintenance fluid giving to a child, okay, over 24 hours must contain potassium, otherwise you would cause him hypokalemia. Okay, and so we have mentioned here that the fluid given to as a maintenance, as a correction for any patient should contain dextrose plus sodium chloride plus potassium with varying concentrations of dextrose and the sodium depending on the condition. Okay, so having a case of hypernatremia, you would give him half normal saline rather than normal saline plus the dextrose. Okay, having a patient with hyponatremia, you can give him the normal saline or even the hypertonic saline, which is 2.7. Okay, 2.7%. The normal saline is 0.9%, while the half normal saline is 0.45%. Okay. So GI losses of potassium also, as in case of persistent vomiting or diarrhea, can be associated with hypokalemia. Renal losses of potassium as with use of diuretics, lobe and diazide, diuretics, osmotic diuresis with DKA, Fanconi, the proximal RTA, renal tubular defect with loss of potassium, Porter syndrome was associated with potassium loss, the same for gentlemen. Also RTA, we have discussed all these Kuhn syndrome, the excess mineralocorticoid effect, Liddle syndrome, excessive action of sodium channels with loss of potassium. Actually in Liddle, okay, there was hypernatremia and hypokalemia. Cushing syndrome, also excessive mineralocorticoid effect. Potassium can shift from the extracellular to intracellular compartment, resulting in hypokalemia, reduction of potassium levels in the serum. This occurs with correction of metabolic acidosis. Take care while you correcting for metabolic acidosis by IV bicarb, you should take care of levels of sodium, okay, as you may cause hypernatremia, calcium, as you may cause hypocalcemia, and potassium, as you may cause hypokalemia. Again, rapid correction of acidosis by sodium bicarb can be complicated by hypernatremia, hypocalcemia, and hypokalemia, as this correction will shift potassium from extracellular to intracellular. The same will occur with insulin treatment, and in treatment of DKA, potassium must be started with insulin treatment, okay, to guard against hypokalemia. And more, insulin should not be started unless you have normal potassium levels to avoid hypokalemia. High dose or prolonged salbutamol treatment for asthma, also salbutamol, will shift potassium intracellularly. And if you note, these are all lines used for treatment of hyperkalemia because they shift potassium intracellularly. In the other hand, hyperkalemia more than 5.5 can be iatrogenic. Okay, you give excess potassium, renal failure, impaired potassium excretion, potassium sparing diuretics like spironolactone if used in overdoses, or maybe shifted from intracellular to extracellular space, the reverse. In case of acidosis itself will shift potassium extracellularly, and in rhabdomyolysis, in muscle crash, will release potassium. Also in tumor lysis syndrome will release potassium. Okay, hypoadrenal state, where we lost the mineralocorticoid effects, as in congenital adrenal hyperplasia, adrenal insufficiency, pseudohypoaldosteronism, all these will end by hyperkalemia. So post-hypokalemia and hyperkalemia, like sodium disturbances, are very dangerous. The danger of potassium level disturbance lie in the arrhythmias. Okay, arrhythmia can occur, and actually we can, all these cases should be put on a monitor, cardiac monitor, to get ECG, as changes in ECG are rapid and can be seen very early in the condition. And fortunately, once you correct the disturbance, the potassium level, correction of ECG will occur. Okay, and you don't need to wait for lab results of potassium. So with cases of hypokalemia, these are the changes. Okay, so we have here prolongation of the QT interval. Okay, QT is now more prolonged. Okay, then appearance of the characteristic U wave. This is the characteristic wave of hypokalemia, with more and more hypokalemia with progression of the condition. So in the flattening of T wave will occur, and the more prominent U wave will occur. More and more advanced cases will be associated with inversion of T wave and prominent U wave. This is the characteristic ECG change in hypokalemia. On the other hand, hyperkalemia, the main ECG change is the peaked T wave. Peaked T wave, this is the most important, and all these cases should be put on cardiac monitor to get these ECG changes. Okay, so hyperkalemia can kill the patient, can cause cardiac arrest in diastole, and so the most appropriate, most urgent step is to give him IV calcium gluconate. So this is very important to protect the myocardium against arrest. Okay, so for stabilization of myocardium, you should give him IV calcium gluconate. Put him on cardiac monitor to follow for presence of the peak T wave, the prolonged PR interval, the widened QRS, and the VF. All these can occur with hyperkalemia. The most important is the peak T waves. Okay. Form as a maintenance in any child exposed to hyperkalemia, like hypoaldosteronism states maybe. So giving him oral calcium rezonium to bind calcium and get rid of it in the stool. Also exclude potassium from the diet and IV fluids. Okay, if your patient is already hyperkalemic, not give him potassium in his fluids. Okay, exclude potassium, give him calcium rezonium orally. In case of severe arrhythmia, give him IV calcium gluconate to protect the myocardium. Then try to shift the potassium intracellularly. Okay, and so treat hyperkalemia. Correct for metabolic acidosis by IV bicarb infusion. Give him salbutamol, either nebulized or IV infusion. Give him insulin plus dextrose infusion to shift potassium intracellularly. Finally, dialysis may be indicated in severe hyperkalemia with levels more than 7 and not 7 milliequivalent per liter and not responding to other measures. Phosphate, okay, phosphate or phosphorus is excreted by the kidney, and this is under control of parathormone. Parathormone hormone encourage phosphorus loss, okay, and not reabsorption, while calcitriol encourage calcium and phosphorus reabsorption from renal tubules and their mineralization in bones. Okay, parathormone has its priority only for the calcium, not for phosphorus. On suspicion of hypophosphatemia, you should calculate the TRB or tubular reabsorption of phosphate. Normally, it should be more than 85%. Having TRB less than 85%, this means you have low TRB, means you have excess phosphate or phosphorus loss or tubular leakage, okay, of phosphorus in urine. Okay, so you will have also a plasma phosphorus low, and the parathormone will not be high. It is not a case of hyperparathyroidism. It is a renal tubular leakage of phosphorus. Okay. While on the other hand, you may do the TRB and find it normal or even up high. It is appropriately if you have hypophosphatemia. So having a hypophosphatemia plus TRB less than 85%, this diagnosed tubular defect. Cause leakage of phosphorus, while having hypophosphatemia associated with high TRB, which is normal, okay, and the low urine phosphorus, this indicates you lose phosphate from other sources other than the kidney. Either dietary phosphorus restriction for any cause, or what's called the hungry bone syndrome. If you have a case of prolonged hyperparathyroidism and the parathyroidism cause resorption of bone, okay, and getting out calcium and the phosphorus from the bone. So after parathyroidectomy, he is exposed to what's called the hungry bone syndrome. Okay, to mineralize the bone excessively with calcium and phosphorus, resulting in hypophosphatemia. Also, in case of renal transplantation after chronic kidney disease with hyperparathyroidism, we have said that chronic kidney disease is complicated by hyperparathyroidism to compensate for the hypocalcemia that was caused by hyperphosphatemia. So when you treat the condition by renal transplantation, so hungry bone syndrome also can occur. And this is an important syndrome called refeeding syndrome. When your patient have prolonged fasting for any cause, the most famous example is the eating disorder, having anorexia nervosa, for example. So he is or malnourished maybe, and he's fasting for long times. After refeeding, this syndrome is expected, and should the refeeding should be done by a specialist dietitian to guard against refeeding syndrome. What occurs with refeeding is excessive insulin secretion, and the insulin will cause shift of phosphorus intracellularly and manifest with hypophosphatemia. And hypophosphatemia can be dangerous and can be complicated even by rhabdomyolysis or rhythm changes. Okay, and so should be taken seriously. Sometimes you have low TRB, okay, and high urine phosphorus, as we have mentioned in Fanconi syndrome and hypophosphatemic rickets. These are the two main categories of hypophosphatemia. Either the TRB is low and we have high urine phosphorus, these are the causes. Or the TRB is high, the kidney is normal, but we have other causes for hypophosphatemia. On the other hand, hyperphosphatemia can occur with tumor lysis syndrome, with rhabdomyolysis, with chronic kidney disease and impair the phosphorus excretion from the body, and in hypoparathyroidism. Okay, finally, hypospadias, having the urethral meatus not in its normal place at the tip of glands, but can be down in the glands itself or in the penis or in the scrotum. And it is actually a sign of hypogonadism, okay, in male infants. And it will be discussed in details in the chapter of endocrinology, searching for its causes. This is a characteristic bend caused by the called Cordy, okay, due to deficient growth of the ventral shaft. Okay, so remember that hypospadias is a sign of hypogonadism. Causes of hypogonadism should be excluded before surgical correction of the case. Okay. Also, understand the testes, another sign of hypogonadism in males that is discussed in details in a chapter of endocrinology. We search for the absent testes by ultrasound, by MRI, or up to laparoscopy. And you should know that you should refer the case with undescended testes at 3 to 6 months of age. Before this, okay, retractile testes is common, and the testes will descend to its normal site by 3 months age. Beyond the 3 months, you should refer the patient for investigations. Surgical fixation of the undescended testes should be done by 9 to 12 months. Otherwise, impairment of fertility can occur if it's done beyond this. Having acute scrotal pain can be a surgical emergency. Those patients should do ultrasound and with Doppler to exclude testicular torsion. So having acute pain in the scrotum can be due to testicular torsion, can be due to torsion of appendix of epididymis, and both are surgical emergencies, but can be less severe. It can be just inflammation in the epididymis. Epididymitis can be trauma or can be hernia. These are the causes of acute scrotal pain. So is it torsion or is it epididymitis? If it is torsion, so it is a surgical emergency and urgent exploration and the correction should be done. Urgent surgical intervention. However, epididymitis is a medical condition that will be treated conservatively and then monitor the patient. So torsion develops suddenly. Within hours, he has sudden onset of acute scrotal pain. But the pain and epididymitis develop gradually over days. Okay? In torsion, you have absent cremastic reflex while it is preserved in cases of epididymitis. Torsion is more in adolescents, while epididymitis is more in sexual active men. In torsion, usually the patient comes with nausea and vomiting plus the acute scrotal pain. Nausea and vomiting are not common here in epididymitis. Usually in epididymitis, you have evidence of inflammation in urine examination, so evidence of urethritis or UTI can be present, while this is absent here. So urgent ultrasound and Doppler to exclude torsion, for which surgical intervention should be done promptly.